Namaste beautiful yogis. Today I am shooting two videos on basically I get a lot of questions and a lot of private messages, and I haven't had time to respond privately to every single person because I'm a new mom and I don't have time for internet as much. Although connecting with you and answering, it is part of my passion and my job, so I generally try to respond to as many of you as I can. But here I'll bunch up a few of the questions that you have sent me into videos. This one is going to be vegan diet during pregnancy and breastfeeding. Now those are my, this is my personal experience, my personal beliefs. I understand that not everybody feels the same or thinks the same way. I'm just sharing what works for me, what my beliefs are, and if that helps some of you, great. Obviously, there is many ways to do things, and there is a natural evolution to where we get from a meat-based diet or animal-based diet to a vegan diet. There is a progression, and not everybody can make the leap. If you can, do it. I can't speak highly enough about a vegan diet. But anyways, let's get started. I haven't written anything down, so I'll just share my kind of my thoughts about it. And if you have questions, please post them below. I get a lot of questions, people being worried about having to go, if they have eaten vegan for say 6 months and they get pregnant, they think they have to go back to an animal-based diet because they think that that's a more appropriate diet for pregnancy. And I understand that that's a very common belief in society, and there is fear obviously with pregnancy because now you're responsible for someone completely else. You're not just making choices for your own self, but you're making choices for another being. So I get the anxiety and the worry for sure, but if it makes you feel any better, avoiding animal products is the single best thing you can do for yourself, for your body, and for another being. Basically, you are providing them with cruelty-free diet, with toxicity-free diet, and because there is a lot of pesticides and hormones and unwanted things in meat and dairy that you're removing from your diet, and also you're replacing that with hopefully vegetables and fruit, and that is what you're gonna nourish your baby with. So how I did it, I'll just give you practical advice, and let's not go into the philosophical part of it. What I did is, when I got pregnant the first 3 months, I was very nauseous. I do believe that there is genius behind the nausea, because it your body wants to not be overloaded with nutrients and doesn't want to be overloaded with iron, and your body wants to rest because you creating the placenta is a massive job. It is a massive job. You'll be tired and rest. Don't fight the tiredness. Rest. Lay. Stay reclined. The nausea makes you want to recline because you can't move when you're nauseous. It makes you wanna puke even more. So I couldn't even shop. I couldn't eat my favorite foods. So I actually lost weight. The first trimester I lost weight, which my doctor wasn't worried about because it's quite common and it doesn't affect the baby. In order for you to get pregnant, you have to have reserves for the first 3 months at least. So the fact that you are getting pregnant means your body is loaded with nutrients and you have enough to sustain the formation of the placenta and then some. So I lost weight, I ate a little bit, and everything made me nauseous. It didn't matter what I ate. So after the first trimester, I started eating and I went back to normal eating. I was craving a little more beans than I normally don't eat beans. So I was eating beans and I was eating fruit. The first trimester I ate citrus every single day and fruit every single day, and roasted bread was what helped me. So get some always buy cucumbers and lemons if you're now in the beginning of your pregnancy journey, because lemon water with grated cucumber in it was the one single most effective thing for nausea. Sour and the cucumber had a refreshing effect. So you would get on the either the big grater or the small side grater, you grate the cucumber. I was getting small Persian cucumbers, and you squeeze a fresh lemon and or lime, and you fill up a jug of water, and that was it. I would drink that, and it would help with the nausea. Also, very fresh sourdough, and very very roasted sourdough. So it's roasted sourdough. That would totally help with the nausea for hours. So that's what helped me. I did eat a lot of blueberries. It was fig season, so I was buying flats of figs, and I was eating a lot of figs actually. So I did have days when I ate normal amount of calories, and certain days when I would just eat lunch, and then I would think, oh, I'll have a nice dinner, and dinner time I would be so nauseous, and I would just skip dinner and go to bed. So that's why I wasn't getting as many calories. But I caught up in the second trimester, and I had caught up before I got pregnant. I had enough nutrition in my body. I was eating really well prior to getting pregnant. And that's another thing. Pregnancy does not start the moment of conception. It starts far before that, of with your mental preparation, mental preparedness, and with your nutritional reserves. And it continues after you give birth. The whole process of you creating, or you being the vessel to bring someone else into this world, is a very long process. It's not just 9 months long. It is a very spiritual process. You are basically, someone just said that in a Native American beliefs is your soul travels out of this dimension, travels to the stars to bring this other soul into this dimension, and it is very much a spiritual process. I was not myself throughout the pregnancy. I was completely in another dimension, very spiritual, very profoundly connected with the divine. It was a beautiful experience. I do think that was a question. Do you think diet has any effect on your spirituality and how you feel during pregnancy? 100% yes. If you wanna be connected to a more divine source, whatever you call that, some people call it Jesus, some people call it higher consciousness, some people call it love, some people call it oneness, universal love, universal consciousness, whatever you wanna call it, that to me doesn't matter. It's the fact is that we all have an awareness of something that is beyond our physical here on this plane awareness. There's something beyond this awareness, and that's what we find ways to describe in different religions or spirituality. So I think the cleaner your diet is, the cleaner your the deeper your connection is with the divine. It's not 100% guaranteed, obviously. Spirituality is not some, there is no magic formula to it, but I think the more you clean your physical body, the more you allow for that connection to happen. That's why fasting, water fasting, those things are very important in developing your spirituality, because you clean that physical body. And fasting is another thing that is a great tool apply before, if you want to get pregnant, before getting pregnant, in order to clean the body so that you can get pregnant. Now, once you get pregnant, I use chronometer. I did track my nutrients, I did track my calories, I tracked everything just to know where I'm at. I used chronometer.com. I tried to include it in the description below. Chronometer.com, that tracks your basic macronutrients, and you can set it for, I set it for 80-10-10, because although I'm not specific about my ratios of macronutrients, I generally tend to intuitively follow the 80-10-10, because some days I eat 15% of fat and some days I eat 5% of fat, and at the end of the month I think it averages out to 10%, just naturally, without me trying it to be 10%. I ate basically for this pregnancy what I ate during the second and third trimester. I did include some beans on, like, say, three days of the week on average. I did like tempeh towards the end of my pregnancy, before birth especially. I loved tempeh, black beans in the second trimester, all other beans, mung beans, lentils, and so forth, millet soup. During the second trimester, I had a lot of dinners that were kabocha squash dinners or potato dinners. And I ate a lot of potatoes, just a lot, just a good amount, good serving of potatoes. I ate fruit for lunch. I always eat only two meals a day. And pregnancy was no exception for me. I skip breakfast, I eat lunch at like 1 or 2 in the morning, and it's a breakfast lunch. And sometimes it's at 3 in the morning, at 3 in the afternoon, or 1 or 2 in the afternoon. And it's usually lunch is going to be a lot of fruit. In the second trimester, I would eat about 700 calories. And then as the second trimester progressed, I would eat 800 calories lunch, 900, 1000, 1200, and so forth. It keeps increasing with your body's needs. Towards the end of the pregnancy, I would eat probably 1500 calorie lunch and 1000 calorie dinner, and sometimes more. So I was eating a lot, I would say enough. Sometimes 3000 calories, and now I'm eating even more as a breastfeeding mom. So do eat a lot. My body was not craving any junk, any salt, so I dropped the salt out, and I dropped all the junky foods out for most of my pregnancy. Towards the end, I ate a few times cakes, vegan cakes and stuff like this, towards the end of the ninth month. But up until that point, I ate very clean. Not because I was thinking I should, because my body wanted that. Basically, I moved through the seasons. First trimester, there was a lot of figs and berries. Then the second trimester, we have a lot of beautiful jujubes here in California. So I ate a lot of jujubes, just a lot of jujubes. A lot of oranges. I did not want to touch bananas through my pregnancy at all. So I avoided bananas, but I ate whatever was seasonal. So as the pregnancy progressed, oranges came into season, then apples came into season. So the third trimester was a ton of apples. There was a ton of persimmons during the second trimester, just a lot of persimmons and grapefruits and so forth. So I ate seasonal, and a lot of it. I would go and buy whatever fruit is in season and it looks good to me. I would buy a lot of it, have it on hand, and eat a lot of it. Melons, watermelons in the first and second trimester. And I'm sure I'm forgetting fruit, but you get the picture. You buy seasonal and you buy a lot of it. And you eat in the second trimester 700 calories at least lunch, and then you keep increasing and your body will guide you. Just eat a lot. On chronometer, you will notice that if you don't make an effort, your zinc will be low, your calcium will be low, and your iron will be low, and you don't want that during pregnancy. So I had to make an extra effort to get, because on chronometer you can set your diet for 80-10-10, but you can also set it for pregnancy. Once you're pregnant, your iron needs are almost twice. It's 1.5 times more iron, and more than that sometimes. You will have to learn what foods have the nutrients that you need. Now, beans and lentils will provide you with a lot of iron. Folic acid tends to not be a problem on a vegan diet. It's more a problem on a standard American diet. So folic acid was pretty much every day. I had more than 100% of folic acid just naturally. All the B vitamins, I had more than 100% naturally. All the other vitamins, minerals, I had more than enough, but I had to make an effort for zinc, iron, and calcium. For those things, I added a lot of spinach, a pound of spinach. I was going for a pound of spinach, or more than a pound of asparagus, or basically I would serve my potatoes or my kabocha squash with that. And I ate cauliflower probably for 3 months, probably almost every night, just a whole head of cauliflower, either steamed or raw or half steamed, half raw. And I'll add that to the kabocha. And cauliflower did add a lot of nutrition to my meals, and it had a very good omega-3 to omega-6 ratio. So just to finish up, calcium, it is added to my nut milk, so there was added calcium to my nut milks. It is in grains, so if you add spinach, if you add romaine lettuce, if you add baby greens, that will add some calcium to your meals. Asparagus, artichokes. If I'm forgetting something, I will include it in the description below, or I'll link it to a blog on my website. Iron, same thing. Lentils, beans, grains, vegetables. You're not gonna get as much iron from your fruit, so you have to add in beans, legumes, basically. And I mentioned omega-3 to omega-6 ratio. Do track that up until you get a good idea of where it is at, your omega-3 to omega-6 ratio. Track it. Squashes have really good high omega-3 to omega-6 ratio. They're not high in fat, they're just the ratio is good. So that's what you're looking at. You're not looking for high fat, you're looking for the good ratio where your omega-3 is. So basically you're looking for at least 1-to-1 omega-3 to omega-6, but better to have higher omega-3, twice as high or something like that. It is hard to get to that, because most things are really high in omega-6, and that's inflammatory. If you are eating too many omega-6s, it's an inflammatory diet. It can create arterial plaque, arterial inflammation, other inflammation in your joints, pain, and so forth. And when you're pregnant, it is very important to watch that ratio for your brain, for the baby's brain development. Grains are really high in omega-3s. Flax, hemp seed, chia seed, cauliflower, as I mentioned, pumpkins, kabocha squash, squashes, those have good ratio. So naturally from your natural diet, you're gonna get omega-3 to omega-6, a good ratio, without adding much fats, in particular nuts or anything like that, just vegetables, some flax, some in melons. If you happen to be pregnant during melon season, you're in love, because they have really good ratio. Now here I actually just made a drink for myself while I'm shooting, but this happens to be sea buckthorn juice, and I did have it during my pregnancy, and I'm having it now if I can find it and if I can buy it. I buy pure sea buckthorn juice. I'll try to links of what I'm buying below in the description, but I try to buy pure sea buckthorn juice, and then I pour this much sea buckthorn juice in the glass, so like a third or a quarter, and then I put some stevia. It doesn't taste, it's not sweet juice, and then water. It has a very high omega-3 content. It is high in fat. It has some astaxanthin, beta carotene. It's loaded with nutrients, omega-9s that are more rare, and so forth. And with the stevia, it tastes great. The reason why I don't add sugar to it is because I drink a lot of it, and it will add up too much processed sugar, even if it's maple syrup. I try not to add sugar to my diet, so I use stevia. Now I did use some supplements, and those are the two brands that I used. I'll link them below. I really love this one, and I recommend this one over anything else. It's Deva Prenatal One Daily. This is Garden of Life Vitamin Code Raw Prenatal. A few other things you can get. Let me get close to the camera. A few other things you can get are vegan, again, Deva flaxseed, B12. This is something just random, phytoceramides. It can help with your skin. It's basically here, the I got it on Amazon, and it is a very interesting supplement because it helps with skin. Here on the label it says reduces crow's feet, lines and wrinkles, rejuvenates, moisturizes and hydrates, renews skin cell from within, repairs sun and skin damage, strengthens collagen. So people take it for beautiful skin. I wasn't taking it every single day, but if I had a growth spurt in my belly, I'll take it to kind of help my skin moisturize from within. I'll link it below because I think it's an interesting supplement to even experiment and take for face skin. So I'll probably buy a couple more bottles and keep taking it and see if it helps with anti-aging as it claims. But I did take some of it during the pregnancy. So basically those are the supplements I took. I didn't take the flaxseed every day, but I bought it only towards the end of my pregnancy and took it just a few times because I was getting the omega-3s from my diet. Now I'll probably take it a little more since I'm breastfeeding. And that's about it with the supplements. I didn't take too many supplements. I did take some herbs towards the end of the pregnancy. Start brewing red raspberry leaf. You can also brew nettles. You can add alfalfa powder to your diet. You can add spirulina. I did add spirulina. Avoid, just on the side note, avoid protein powders with enzymes in them because the papain enzyme can cause contractions and miscarriage. I don't know that it is added in high enough concentration in those powders, but just avoid it. So I did avoid, I was very careful during the pregnancy to not add any supplements that I'm not sure about. I researched everything and I just added things that I was kind of sure are kind of safe. Yeah, so avoid papain, avoid bromelain because those can cause contractions in the uterus. Avoid, avoid most oils, most essential oils, just use the safe ones. I stuck with therapeutic grade lavender for massages and everything else because that's safe. There is oils that should be avoided at all cost during pregnancy, like jasmine oil, clary sage oil, and so forth. I did use the oils in the rose family, rose geranium, rose autumn, and all of those. I did use those, use them for my face and my belly. And let me think. I think that kind of covers everything. Eat a lot of calories. Eat at least 2 pounds if you can of greens, say 1 pound of spinach. And if you cook it, it cooks down really small, so it's easy. If you blend it in a smoothie, then you have it that way. And then maybe just a head or two of romaine hearts. Add sugar snap peas, add green beans, peas, corn, all of those, carrots, add all the vegetables that are available in your country. Brussels sprouts. I was nauseous from Brussels sprouts, so I couldn't eat Brussels sprouts. So just work with your body. Generally, I love broccoli, but I couldn't have broccoli during the pregnancy, and I just didn't have broccoli, but I did have cauliflower. I had cabbage. I'm sure I'm missing, obviously I ate a lot during the pregnancy, so I'm missing some of the things I ate. The first trimester we did go out a lot to restaurants because I just couldn't cook and couldn't look or shop for food. So we went out and I had some Thai cuisine, vegan Thai and things like this. So just whatever, like we'll go to a restaurant and I'll have, I even had my first deep dish vegan pizza. One night after a concert, we went to a really nice a restaurant that offers vegan pizza. It was fantastic. So I had a little more kind of like restaurant experience during the first trimester. Then during the second, I ate super pure, clean stuff. And that would be my main advice, is listen to your body. Your body will be very particular about what it wants. I was very particular. I would go like, today I absolutely must have black beans with romaine lettuce, and I would get that. And I was very particular about having citrus every single day from during this pregnancy. From the day I found out I'm pregnant all the way till the day I gave birth, there was citrus in my diet every single day. Another thing to have every single day in abundance is water and tea. Just have a lot of water and tea, a lot. We're talking about at least 2 liters, but if you add tea a little more. After my fourth or fifth month, I started having coffee. I know for some people coffee is an absolute no-no. For me, it's been pretty, I drink coffee during the winter and I don't drink it during the summer, and I seem to benefit from it. It is a warming drink. I seem to benefit from it. If you think coffee is the devil, avoid it. For me, it's always worked well. I think because I'm a pretty athletic person and it increases your oxygen uptake. I think that covers everything. I will try to just kind of summarize what I did. Have a lot of water. Have citrus every single day because that will help with preventing stretch marks, and it will prevent varicose veins and hemorrhoids. So don't skip on the citrus. Have tangerines, oranges, grapefruits, lemon juice, lime juice. Every single day, the more the better. I did have a ton of oranges, then a ton of tangerines, whatever was in season, I had a lot of that. If you hear squeaky sounds, that baby sleeping. She makes a lot of little squeaky sounds and I call her Squeaky. And I love those squeaky sounds. So I think I kind of covered just the basics. Be confident, listen to your body, have a lot of protein and a lot of greens, and you're not gonna have weird cravings. Have a lot of fruit. Don't have one apple and think, okay, I had fruit. And have a lot of fruit, because if you don't have a lot of fruit, you will have a lot of junk later on, and your body does not want junk food. Your body wants nutrient dense food. When you're pregnant, that's the time when every calorie counts. So when I'm not pregnant, sometimes I would let myself have, like, say chocolate and wafers or something weird like that. When I was pregnant, I didn't have any of that because wafers have no nutrition. You're going to have so many calories with nothing that provides nutrition to your baby or to your body. So don't just pack on the good food. Here in LA, we have a lot of other fruits like dates and cherry moyas and stuff that I was having in abundance. But wherever you live, if you live in a different country, obviously, you have whatever is local to you. You have pears, you have cherries, you have strawberries. I had, going towards birth, I started having a ton of dates. I probably ate in the month leading up to birth 40 pounds of dates because it was my staple. I was buying, let's see, not 40, 25 pounds probably. I was buying those flats, 11 pound flats of dates, which is 5 kilos. And I was just having that for lunch with apples and dates in little sandwiches. I would just chop everything and eat it in sandwiches because it's enjoyable that way. And also I find it when I make sandwiches of fruit, I slow down So I have time to chew and to kind of be conscious of my food. Drink water before meals, not during and not after meals. And all of that, the water will prevent you from getting stretch marks, and it will keep you regular. It will keep you, that's another thing, fruit and water will keep you regular, so you're not gonna deal with constipation and other issues that other women deal during pregnancy. Dairy causes congestion and raises the risk for your child to have asthma and respiratory issues, so be confident that you're doing something good for your child when you're avoiding dairy. Now, after you give birth, your hormones will just drop and other hormones will just rise. So that's why people get postpartum depression and so forth, because... one second, let's see. I think Miss Lotus is hungry, so I might not be able to shoot my second video, but let's finish up. Do be confident that when you're not eating animal products, you're removing hormones that are animal hormones from your diet. So you're going to feel good after you deliver, because you're not going to have all these hormones affecting your body and causing havoc in your body. So you feel good, you feel positive, you feel emotional and spiritually connected, but you won't feel depressed, or at least you will increase your chances of that. That was my experience. I will talk about a lot more about depression and all of that in a different video, but right now I think pay attention to baby. So I'll see you soon. Namaste.